In this video, we're going to create a Microsoft SQL Server link server to broker all of our writes to the data archive as part of our SSIS package. A Microsoft SQL Server link server is basically a wrapper around an Oledb data source that presents itself as a SQL server to third-party clients. If something is set to connect to a SQL server, the SQL server can then pass the connection to the Oledb data source on its behalf. For example, a third-party application can interact with the SQL server while the SQL server in the backend, unknown to the client, is interacting with the Pi system via Oledb. There are a few pros and cons to using this method, and it depends on the exact situation on whether or not you should use a link server, or else just use a direct Oledb connection to the Pi system. For example, when using a SQL Server link server, the data flow is changed. Instead of the client connecting directly to the Pi system, it connects only to the SQL server. This means that your network from the client to the SQL server is all that needs to be opened, and you do not need to open ports to connect to the Pi system, as well as the software that's installed on the client machines only needs to include SQL Server Native Client, which should be installed by default by the operating system on a Windows machine. By contrast, if you're making a direct connection to the Oledb data source, you'll need to have the Oledb provider installed on every machine. Across a large enterprise, this could be a difficult task to maintain by the IT department. From a security perspective, the extra layer introduces SQL Server security, which adds a few more options and also makes it a little less trivial to configure. This can be both a pro and a con, as it could give you more options, however, could take more steps to complete successfully. From a machine resource perspective, using a SQL Server link server allows all of your connections to go through the SQL Server, which is a server. This allows your client to be thin and pass off all the work to the SQL Server, even if you're using Pi Oledb Provider and Pi Oledb Enterprise, which are executed client-side for the query processing, because in this case, the client itself would be the SQL Server, and your client for the application is a true thin client. If you were using an Oledb data source directly, all this query processing would be on the client. However, in the RTQP data model, this isn't much of a difference, because the query processing is already happening on the AF server and not on the client in the first place. From a compatibility perspective, there may be some third-party tool that you're using that can only connect to SQL servers. It cannot connect to Oledb data sources, for example. Therefore, you could use the SQL Server link server as a wrapper around the Pi system, such that it uses a SQL connection, but in reality is getting data from an Oledb data source. And finally, the reason that we're going to use it in this instance is the fact that we're writing to a tag. Anytime you're writing to a tag using the buffer subsystem on a Pi system, the buffer subsystem creates a buffer lock on that tag. If you're then having a bunch of clients writing to that same tag from, let's say, multiple different dev machines building out the SSIS package, you can get into a buffer lock situation if the client machine that you're using does not have Pi buffer subsystem installed, whereas another machine that's running the same tool during development does have it installed. By keeping everything on one machine in terms of who is writing to the tag itself, we're able to get around these problems very easily. In this instance, we just need to make sure that the Pi buffer subsystem is installed and configured on the SQL server hosting the link server, and any client machine executing this SSIS package, whether in production or in development, is able to successfully write to the tag. To get started, let's open up SSMS and look at the link server options. Under server objects, we see link servers and providers. Here we have a list of all the providers that are installed on the machine, including Pi Oledb Provider, Pi Oledb Enterprise, and Pi SQL Client. In this situation, we're going to be using Pi Oledb Provider. Now, to make sure we configure everything correct, let's go to the OSIsoft Tech Support website and find the KB that was written to assist in the creation of link servers. Here I've signed into the Tech Support website of techsupport.osisoft.com, and I'll go to My Support and search knowledge base. I'll click on KB articles and I'll start typing link server. Here we see how to configure a link server with Pi Oledb or Pi Oledb Enterprise. So I'll click on that. And here we have the steps to configure it by starting off with the provider properties and then moving into the link server properties. In this specific KB, the Pi Oledb provider properties are in orange, so let's go through and configure our link server. We'll right-click on Properties for the provider and fill in these values. Now we'll right-click on Link Servers and create New Link Server. Now for the security option, we'll have everything just pass straight through with Windows Security. Under Server Options, we'll return to the KB and look to see what it says. We'll right-click on the link server and test connection and see that it works. We expand out, we can see all the catalogs we saw earlier in PySQL Commander. Let's open that now to prove it. All the catalogs listed on the right are listed on the left as well. Now let's execute a simple query in PySQL Commander and execute the same query in the Microsoft SQL Server Link Server. Right-click on PyComp2 and execute predefined query. This is the last hour of values for Sinusoid, and we'll copy this over and execute it on the SQL Server. We'll need to give it a context of which link server we're talking about, and we can execute the query. We notice that it fails because the date and or time cannot be converted from the character string that was provided into something usable by the SQL Server. This is because the Microsoft SQL Server is actively trying to process this statement. Star and star minus 1H are not Microsoft SQL Server syntax, they're Py syntax. So there's two ways around this. The first is that we can change these to static timestamps. So let's do that now. And let's execute this query. Now that we've given it static timestamps for the last 5 hours, we can see some values appear. This is because the SQL Server knows how to parse these state time strings, as opposed to the asterisks and asterisks minus 1H that we gave it earlier. We could also use dynamic timestamps with T-SQL. For example, using the date add and get date T-SQL functions to get an hour from now and now as our two timestamps. When we execute that, we see that we have one value returned. From this, you can see that whenever you use the Microsoft SQL Server to parse your queries, you need to make sure that you're speaking the language that the Microsoft SQL Server can understand. Another alternative is to use what's called an open query, and I'll show that now. With open query, we pass a query string to a link server, and the Microsoft SQL Server does not try to process anything. It simply hands off the query provided to the link server provided and displays the results, in this case by saying select star from the result. When doing this, we also have to escape the quotes because the PyLDB provider needs to have the quote provided to it. Let's execute this query and make sure that it returns the results that we expect. So in this instance, we're using the Microsoft SQL Server link server. However, we're providing it with Py syntax. So these are the two options, and it really depends on your situation on whether you want to use open query or use the direct query. Now for our SSIS package, we're going to want to write a value to the Py server using this link server, so let's make sure that we can do that now. Let's open up the query file that we had before, and let's execute this within an open query. Let's execute the query. When we try to do this, we see the error message that we cannot process the insert statement because there are no columns or the user does not have permissions on the object. If you ever receive an error message like this, I encourage you to look at our tech support website to see if you can find the answer already in one of our KBs, or just simply open a tech support case with one of our tech support representatives. In the interest of time on this video, I'm going to jump directly to the answer, which is found in our PyOledb provider user documentation. Here we see are PyOLEDB-specific initialization properties, one of which is always return row set. The description is, if set, all SQL commands return row sets containing the number of rows affected by the execution. This property enables execution of non-query commands as pass-through SQL Server queries. This is exactly what we're doing right now by passing through an insert statement through the link server to the PyOLEDB provider. So we need to change our link server properties to include this OLEDB property. So if we go into our link server and we right-click on it, we go to properties, and we'll see that the provider string as well as many other items on the configuration are grayed out. This is because once a Microsoft SQL Server link server is created, it needs to be deleted before it can be changed. Luckily, it's not as difficult as simply deleting the link server entirely and starting over, but instead can be scripted very easily by right-clicking on the link server. So let's do that now. Right-click, go to Script Link Server As, drop and create to New Query Window. What this is a sequence of commands that starts off by dropping the link server that we have and then recreating it using all the configuration items that we already provided to it. This means that all we need to do is change the provider string here in this script, run it, and our link server will never actually appear to be deleted. So let's do that now. Let's find the provider string, and let's add two more properties. We'll execute this, show that it completed successfully, and I'll right-click and go to Properties of our link server and see that our provider string has changed. As you can see, this was a relatively straightforward process, and our link server never appeared to disappear at any time. So now let's go back and execute that query that gave us the error last time. Now we see the affected row count is 1, and we did not get any error messages. Let's run this query to make sure that we have written the value successfully. Great. Here is our test from before, and here is our test now. Now our query is ready to be used within our SSIS package, which we'll build out in our next videos. This concludes the video on Microsoft SQL Server link servers, when to use them, and how they work. Thanks for watching.